Welcome back to session 2 of data structures and applications. This is Dr. S. Nandagopalan. Let us resume the session 2. Let me just share the PPT. We have discussed about the word processing functions, basically insertion, deletion, and replacement. This is the slide I think we have been discussing in the previous session. So insertion, I have already explained about the basic working of this, where insert is a function which takes three parameters, that is the given text, the position, and the string to be inserted. What is position? Position is nothing but where this new string is to be inserted. For example, if this is the given string A, B, C, D, E, F, G, from third position onwards, you can see here, the new string X, Y, Z must be inserted. Similarly, at 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 onwards, the new string has to be inserted. So whatever be the length of this string to be inserted, it should sit, you know, after the position what is specified in the function called insert. Now we have explained yesterday, that means the previous session, about the way in which it could be done. So what we do is we just try to split the string up to this position called 3, that is 3 minus 1, because we don't want third onwards, we have to insert from third, hence we need to calculate this length as 1 less than the given position. So that's why you can see here the position minus 1, that means 2 in this case, our example. So we have two positions, two characters rather. Then we have to insert this. How do we do that? We just concatenate. So whatever the string to be given, we just, you know, concatenate. So the third parameter is nothing but, the third function, you know, the functionality or the working of this is this substring. So we need to get the remaining portion, that is C, D, E, F, G in our example, to be concatenated again. That means we have to get, starting from here, all the rest. So we can just understand this sequence of operations, which will be explained using this slide. So this, up to this, it is the same formula which we have seen in the previous slide. So let us start with the example here, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and we need to extract, starting from first, a substring up to the this position, that means these two characters, because our insert function should insert the new string X, Y, Z starting from third, that means 1 less. You can see here length, the pattern, the position minus 1. So starting from 1, the position minus 1. So that is the substring which it would extract. So in our example, we have starting from 1, 3 minus 1, 2. That means 2 characters, that is length of the character, will be extracted. That the result of this is AB. Next, we have S. What is S? You can see here, S is the things to be inserted. In our case, it is XYZ. So AB concatenated with XYZ is nothing but AB XYZ. So we have got up to this. Now we have to calculate now this one and concatenate with this as a third string. So what is the third formula? Third expression we have here, the substring. We have the text, now the pattern, length of T, etc., etc. So we have explained already the previous session. So what is the text? A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Then what is the position? Starting from third. Then length of text is actually 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So 7 minus position is 3. 7 minus 3 plus 1. So 4 plus 1, 5 characters. So you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 5 characters is nothing but C, D, E, F, G. So the result of this is nothing but this. So in order to extract the substring after this position, that means we need C, D, E, F, G. So we can calculate very easily from this length of the entire text. We just subtract the pattern, that means starting from 3 plus 1. So we will get the remainder. So this is basically to calculate the entire size of the substring after the position. So we get C, D, E, F, G. So when I concatenate that again with this A, B, X, Y, Z, so I get the final string. So we can actually insert any given string starting from any given position by using these three separate statements. First one is substring, second one is given string to be inserted, the third one is your substring again. So this is the way in which the insert works. Now let's move on to deletion. Now what is the meaning of deletion? Again, given text is the first parameter, the position and the length to be deleted. That means length of the substring to be deleted. Now let's consider these two examples. Number one is this A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Now the position is 4. That means 1, 2, see this 2, 3, 4. So starting from 4, I want to delete two characters, that is DE. You can see here I have given in red with the striking of these two characters. So starting from fourth character, we want to delete two characters, that means length from this. Similarly, if I have starting from second, that is B onwards, four characters, B, C, D, E, you can see here B, C, D, E, then after deleting, the result is AFG. So how are we going to, you know, get this deletion done as per this parameters given? So it's very easy. We will just see the logic or the method. So this is again similar to the insertion. Now we have two, expressions or substring statements which would actually perform this deletion. So what is the first one? It is extracting the first portion, you know, the substring. So what we can do is we can start from the first character and extract up to, because this is the position, minus 1. So because we need the first three characters only. So in order to get these first three characters, we will get a substring starting from the first character. So this is my P, because that is the fourth character in this example. This is my P, this is 1. So 1 to P minus 1 is ABC. So we will get this substring, because the idea is get this substring FG and concatenate these two. So automatically this much will be dropped. So that is the idea. So in order to extract the first substring starting from first character up to position minus 1, we can easily do that. You can see here the first character to position minus 1. So with this, I would actually get this ABC. Now what is the next one? I want to get this, right? So I have to get my pointer, that means starting from here. So the second parameter is starting from position plus the length, how many characters you want. So for example, here P is 4 plus 2 is 6. So you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I got this. So in order to get the first character for the second substring, I need to simply add these two. That means the position and the length. So my pointer will come here. So this is my starting. Now all the remaining characters I need. That means the length of that. So how do I calculate that length? Again, same formula, like, you know, get the full length of the entire text. So we have the full length as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this is 7 minus what is position? It is 4. What is L? That is, so we have 2, which is the length to be deleted. So that is 2 plus 1 in order to get the full length. So I have 7 as the full length. So minus 4, I will be moving my pointer past 4. Then P, that is 4, L is the length of the character to be deleted, that is 2 plus 1. So what I have here, 7 minus 6 is 1 and 2. So I get this, you know, 2 characters. So basically, starting from this, which is P plus L, 2 characters I can easily get as a substring. So FG I get. So this entire substring will give me FG. So ABC concatenated with FG is nothing but ABC FG. So that's exactly what this slide explains. The same formula is repeated. So the first substring starting from 4, the character, extract only 2. 4 starting from first, 4 minus 1, that is this one, P minus 1. And then the second one, as I've just now explained, starting one is 4 plus 2, and the remaining one length, you have to move the pointer up to this, you know, P plus L, and get the complete length by using this formula. So we get 2 characters FG, and finally we get the concatenated one, which is ABC FG. So we can easily extract the length or the position using this formula. Okay, now let's move on to, see, this is actually, you can see here, delete text position length. So you should know in advance that I'm going to delete these many, and you should also know where is the position. Now sometimes deletion you may want to do by giving the pattern. So this particular function, what we are trying to do here is delete the first occurrence of a given pattern, let's say, in the text T. So I can simply say delete in the given text, let's say P. Don't get confused, P with position. P means pattern. Okay. So what is the pattern here? Any given pattern as a string. Okay, now let's take an example. Right, let's assume that this is the given string A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and what is the pattern? C, D. Now the pattern actually exists here in the given text only once. Now, supposing if it's repeated in several places in the text, it will not delete all occurrences. I'll show you that later, deleting all occurrences of this pattern in the text. So this will delete only the first occurrence. So what is the method? The method is to find. So the idea is that we just drop this CD. We don't require, you know, the position. We don't require the length to be nothing. We simply give the text and the, you know, pattern. Okay. So now how do we do that? We can easily use the existing, you know, functions which I've already seen. For example, we know that how to get the position of this CD which occurs in the text using index. So what index does? It actually finds the position of this pattern in the text. So it gives the number where it occurs. Okay. Now what happens? Then how many characters to be deleted, because this pattern has to be deleted, length of the pattern. So essentially, what we are trying to do here is that what we have given in the previous case as the position to be deleted as per the given text, given pattern in the text, and how many characters to be. So all these numbers were given in the previous case. You can see here, text, position, and length. Instead of this, we just give the patterns. So from this pattern, we derive the position and the length. So essentially, this leads to the previous case. But only thing is that we are using some additional functions. So index, where exactly this pattern occurs in the text can be obtained by using index. Okay, so the same function delete, but given as extra functions like index and length. So what is length of the pattern? It is 2. So we can essentially say that delete in the text starting from 3, 2 characters. So starting from 3 is this, right? 2 characters is CD. So it is same. So that's the idea. So the result is what? AB, EFG. So CD is gone. So it is so simple that even if we are trying to delete a given pattern in a text, we can actually do this by using the function called index and also the function called length. So this is pattern delete. Okay. Now supposing assume that I want to delete all occurrences. Supposing assume that I get say something like this. I'll just take a pen. Okay, so A, B, C, D, E, F, G, say some X, then again C, D, let's say Y. So this is my text, given text. So now I have 2 places. CD is appearing here, CD is appearing here, right? That means I need to delete this. CD could appear even elsewhere in the text, but assume that it appears twice in this text. So what I have here is that in this normal delete, I would actually get only the first CD being deleted. Okay, this is deleted. But now what we want to do is we want to delete this as well. That means all occurrences of CD or any given pattern. So how do we do it? We need to repeat this deletion process with an iteration. That means you have to repeat the same. Repeat means iterate or do this deletion again, okay, until you reach the end of the string. So essentially, one delete, multiple delete, it all depends. So we can just show this using the function here or an algorithm here. Given text and pattern, let's assume that that's the delete, that is text and pattern. Now we can have, the starting point, that is K, being set as the first occurrence of this pattern in the text. So I'll just save that position. So like in this case, what my example shows, so I'll just pick the pen again here. So 1, 2, 3. So this is third position is the one where my K will have, right? And K is not 0 because pattern is there. Supposing the pattern is not there, it would return 0 and I don't need to do anything. So let's assume that it's a found case where my pattern is there in the text. So my K will have this value 3, And now I can establish the loop as long as k is not. That means as long as the pattern is not there in the rest of the text. So k is not equal to 0 because k is 3. So now I can apply this as usual, the formula t comma index t, you know, all that. And this would give me the deleted portion. That means after deletion, I will get the rest of the text. So for example, in this case, after deleting, I'll get A, B, E, F, G, X, C, D, Y, right? So this is dropped, C, D is dropped. So I would get A, B, E, F, G, X, C, D, Y. So that will be the fresh string now, sorry, text now, where I would search for again the pattern, whether it is there or not. So what I do, I'll set again K, because K, this is only once it will be executed, right? So I would again set my K for the next occurrence of K, I mean pattern in the text. So that would give me the K value. So K value this time will be 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this is my K value. So what happens? K is not 0. Again, it will come. So that is also gone, actually. This is gone. So next to CD is also gone. This is gone. This is also gone. What is the new text now? A, B, E, F, G, X, Y. So that will again go here. And what is the index here set K after deleting? The index value for the new text, that is without both the CDs, will be 0 because pattern is not there in the modified text after deleting both the CDs. So when you come back to this step 2, so two iterations are over. First iteration, first pattern. Second iteration, second pattern. So eventually the text will not have CD and hence K value will be 0. So when you come back here, you will see that it is equal to 0. The condition is false and it will come here and output T or return T or write T. So what T will have? A, B, E, F, G, X, Y. So that's the working of this delete text comma pattern. So it's very simple that we call this delete or we execute this delete, you know, twice in this case. How many ever times your pattern occurs, those many times the repeat while loop will be executed. As long as it's true, it keeps working, otherwise it comes out. So when the pattern is not there in the text, obviously the index value, I mean, whatever the index function will give you 0. And hence we can come out. So the escape mechanism or the breaking of the loop is basically K not equal to 0. So we can easily, you know, find the pattern in the text if it's there. If so, delete, else come out. The other important function here is called as the replacement. Now, this is quite common in most of the word processing applications, including Microsoft Word. See, in the previous example, we have searched for the pattern in the given text and deleted it, fine, how many ever times it appears. But supposing, assume that I want to search for a pattern in the given text and replace it with some other given string called as a replacement string. So let me call this as, let me pick the highlighter, given text, given pattern, given replacement string. So pattern, if it exists in the text, you should actually replace with this. Now this is a bit tricky, so we'll see an example to understand this concept. So this is a given text, X, A, B, Y, A, B, Z. Now remember, again, it will replace only the first occurrence. If you want all occurrences to be replaced, then you have to again adopt the same method as we have just now seen, using a while loop or a repeat loop or a for loop. Right, for loop, I think it's not possible because we don't know how many times this pattern exists in text. So I think indefinite loop like while is better or is appropriate. Okay, so the first occurrence is AB here, which will be replaced. So this, sorry, let me just take. Yeah, so this AB will be replaced with a dollar. You can see here it's done. And this second appearance of AB in the text is not replaced with dollar. So it remains as it is. So pattern is formed and it is replaced with the replacement string. How do we do this? How do we implement this? Right? So it's very simple that first occurrence, the logic is deletion followed by insertion. So this is the thumb rule or a simplest way. So deletion followed by insertion. So what we do is we will find the position of this pattern in the given, same thing like previous case. Okay, so get that position, that index function where given text is this and pattern is there here. And so we get K where we have this, the position. I've just marked this position using red, so don't get confused. Okay, I'll use a pointer here. Right. So this is the position where the pattern, is there in the text. Now from there, we need to delete how many characters length of this pattern. So you can see here in the given text at position K, that is second one, delete these many characters. How many characters? Length of this. Two characters. So AB is gone. So you can see here AB is gone. After executing this delete, I would get X, Y, A, B, Z. Y, A, B, Z. So basically, I want to first remove this first occurrence of the pattern here. Okay? Right. Now, after removing this, I would get a substring like X in this case given. This is not over because I need to actually replace this, right, with the given replacement string. So we know where this occurs, second position onwards. Now we have removed this, so deletion is over, so this is over. Now we have to insert what? Insert the replacement string. So what we do is, since we know the position already and we have also removed this, so starting from this, I would actually insert, so this is gone, or here. I would insert my replacement string, that is dollar. Okay, so that's exactly what, final string is. So starting from the index position where the pattern occurs, first you remove this or delete this much, that's the size of the pattern, and you will get a substring, and in that substring insert the replacement string. So that's exactly what it's done. So now I have the final answer. Okay, so what I have here is, let me just summarize this. Deletion followed by insertion. Let me just delete all this or erase this. So get the position for removal and it's removed using the length, whatever be the size of the pattern. So you get X, Y, A, B, Z, and you know the position, where it should be inserted with the replacement string. So that insert will take care. So all that you need to do is execute these three statements, you will get actually the replacement. So you don't require anything. Now supposing if you want to replace all occurrences of this, again similar to the previous example, you need to just establish a while loop until again find the K, etc., etc. As long as k is not equal to 0, you can keep doing these instructions being executed. So the same method can be used, that you can take it as an exercise and then try this kind of thing. So if we have, once you write the functions, maybe in C or C++ for index, for delete, for length, and for insert, etc. Now the complicated functions like insertion, replacement can easily be returned using the sub functions or sub algorithms like what I have explained just now. Okay, now let us move on to the last section of our discussion, called as pattern matching algorithms. Well, what is this pattern matching algorithms? As we have just now seen, the replacement or insertion, deletion, etc. Now we are going to look into the straightforward methodology rather than using the sub functions or sub algorithms like delete followed by insert or use some index, all that kind of thing. It's not required. We can actually do this same work by using some kind of brute force method. That means some common sense methodology we can apply. So brute force is nothing but we can apply from first principles or with our common sense or with our previous knowledge, we can actually do this kind of pattern matching. So pattern match algorithms, there are two which we are going to study in this course. The first one is a brute force method, where it is a straightforward common sense method, and the second one is bit faster, because this method, common sense method or a brute force method, is bit slow. The second one is bit efficient in the sense that repeated scanning is not required. Okay, right. Let us now understand this brute force method. It's very simple. Follow me, then you can very easily understand. Don't get confused. I will show you with the number of examples, with the number of use cases, because scenarios may change. So what we are going to study, what is the problem statement here? Given a source string, welcome to say let's say BIT, and the pattern string ACOM. If the pattern is found in the given string, source string, then return the position of that string. Position of that pattern which appears in the source. Now, else, maybe you can return -1 or null or whatever it is. So that I'll show in the algorithm. So this does not use any other functions which we have already discussed. It is a straightforward algorithmic approach which most of the packages, most of the software use. Okay. Now what we are going to do is we are going to maintain two pointers. Let's say I and J are these two pointers. What is I pointer? I pointer will point to the source string. J pointer will point to the pattern string. Okay, so we have two pointers. I think I will just take pen here rather than the highlighter. Right, so I have two pointers. So this is my I. Right, and this is my J. Right, okay, this is my J pointer. Now what we are going to do is we are going to compare character by character pointed by these two pointers, one the source, another one is the pattern. It's a common sense. Now, supposing you can see here, source string pointed by I, pattern string pointed by J. Now, let us say that it matches. Let us say, don't worry about this. Let us say that both S of I and the P of okay, P of J matches, no problem. But it's not no problem, we had to actually check each and every character. How long you will check? You will have to check until each and every character in the pattern matches with this. So what I do is, I'll have to compare, I mean, don't worry about this particular bullet. For the moment, don't look at this. Just concentrate on this only. That is, assume that the first two characters, source and pattern, matches. What we are supposed to do, we should compare all the remaining characters in the pattern again to see whether it matches with this text or the source. If every character in the pattern matches with all this, you know, that means it's found. Okay, so we can say that return the position, right? So we have to increment J, we have to increment I. For the moment, assume like that. We are not going to do that anyway. So I is incremented. Let's assume this is O, matches third. So J is also incremented, obviously. J points to the third character M. Assume that this is also M. So what I'm trying to say is that, let us assume that the source also starts with COM. So character pointed by I, character pointed by J, character pointed by I, second one. Character pointed by J, second. Character pointed by the third one in source, character pointed by pattern J, that is the third. Everything matches, that's done. Now, if any mismatch is there, so now we will remove this. Even the first character, there is a mismatch. Now, what are we supposed to do? Now, once the mismatch occurs, J has to be again here, and mismatch may occur anywhere, and I has to be incremented, because we have already checked this. We have to start checking from here, because my pattern may be there starting from the second character in the source. So it could be COM here. Now that's the problem. Okay, now we don't actually, now this is understood, let's assume. Don't worry, I'll explain with some more examples in the next slide. And actually, we don't increment I in order to compare every character in the pattern pointed by J. Why? Because if there is a mismatch, right? If there is a mismatch, see, pattern maybe CO could match, but this could be something else. So what happens? I would have already advanced to so many characters, and you have to again start comparing from the mismatch position. So we don't want to come back again and then start comparing with the first character of the pattern. So what we do is, we will have some kind of, you know, indexing methodology. I think you'd already studied indexing methodology, where what we do, we compare, we don't actually increment I straight away, but we will increment I with respect to J. So you can see here, I is, let's say, 0, starting 1, J is 0. So S of 0 plus 0 is 0th character W, and we compare this with pattern of J, which is P of 0, P of J. So we compare this. So what happens here is that S of 0 is W, P of 0 is C. So there is a mismatch. Okay. Now what happens is that next we increment I, again the same thing happens, J remains same. Now let's assume for the moment that there is a match. Okay. Now I'll assume COM. So what happens? S of 0, 0 matches, right? J is incremented. So J points here. J points here. And what happens with I is not incremented. You can see here. So I remains same, 0 only. 0 plus J is 1 now. So 1. S of 1 is what? O. So don't worry about this. O. So what happens is that is also matching. Next, J is incremented, J comes here, and then we compare again 0, 1, 2. So 0 plus 2 is 2. So we compare with N. Okay, we compare with N. Now there is a mismatch. There is a mismatch. So J has moved to almost 0, 1, 2 second character position. I is not moved. I remains at 0 only, because we don't know whether the pattern will be there or not. There may be a mismatch in the last character. So we have to again start comparing from first position, not from the way, you know, match which we have done earlier. So now what happens, that since I was 0 only, now I'll increment I to 1. Now I will start comparing from here. Right? So even if there is a mismatch, I don't need to come back, right, etc. So instead of moving incrementing I, and eventually when there is a mismatch coming back again, it's all headache. So what we do is we adopt the simple indexing methodology, starting from the initial address of source, that is 0. We just, with respect to J, we try to compare. Okay. Now, supposing if there is a mismatch, what we do is we will reset J to again 0, and I will point to this position, second one, and start compare. So that is the logic which we use here. I'll explain that with this trivial case where just now what I said in the previous example. So what we have here is that outer for loop is required to scan through. See, in order to build the algorithm, see, there should be one, you know, outer for loop, one for loop rather, which will scan through starting from here up to the last. Actually, it need not be the last, because it could be length of the source minus length of the pattern, that is N minus M, you can see here. Why? Because we don't need to, because if I here last position, you know, the pattern, there will be some size. There is no point in checking this. So at least I need to check for the size of the pattern. So for which my pointer should be at this position, so that N minus M characters at least. For example, here it is 14 minus 3, 11. So starting from 11, 3 character position, I can easily check. So let me just just repeat the same thing what I have explained in the previous case. So this is my I pointer, and this is my J pointer, right? So C is compared with W. No, there is a mismatch. Whenever there is a mismatch, okay, now you have to move I pointer straight up. There's no point in checking other characters in the pattern. So I is moved to this, right? Now again, compare E with C. No, there is a mismatch. So move I again. Now L is compared with C again. There is a mismatch, okay? Now again move I. So this is my current I, right? Current I. Now, because this is the outer for loop, which will make this I movement until this N minus M, right? Now we need one more for loop, which is inner for loop. For what? For checking each and every character to the size of this pattern, because once we have a match, for example, in this case, I is matching with C. Now we can't declare that the pattern is found in the source. So what we should do? We should actually compare the remaining characters of the pattern as well. Well, now what we do is to compare C with C. Done. I will remain here only. So I plus J. So now what happens? J is moved because there is a match. So I plus J is what? I plus J is nothing but 3 plus 1, 4. So fourth character is O, it is matched. Again, I is more, I is 2, sorry, J is 2, I remains 3, that is 5. Fifth character is matched. Again, there is a match. I is not moved. So it is I plus J. S of I plus J with P of J. Okay. So now we have all three characters. So this length, inner for loop will be executed for the length of the pattern. Okay. Now what happens? All the three characters. So this, we get the end of this. So this is the end of the pattern. So we can return what? I. Simply return I or I plus 1 if you want the actual position. Because C strings actually start from 0. So if you want a conventional 1, 2, 3 kind of thing, you can say I plus 1 or you can simply return I. So we know that where this pattern occurs. Finished. So first occurrence of this pattern is found in this. Okay, let us take not found case. Oh, sorry. This is another scenario where, there is a confusion here that the first character is matching, but actual pattern is appearing after the this one, you know, this C. So let us come up to this now, I, to save time, and J is here. Right, J is here. Now there is a match. So I'll move J to check whether my second character in the pattern matches with the second character here. So I plus J. So what is I? 3. So what is J? It is 1. That is fourth character. It is not matching, you can see. Okay, now what I do? I'll reset my J back to this. So this is gone. Reset my J and now starting from the next, because it is a mismatch, I should actually start checking from the next character. So I move my I. Outer for loop will do that. Starting from. So again, S of I plus J to P of J. So it's matching. J is moved. It's matching. J is moved. It is matching. I remains here only. So return I. That is here. So this is my pattern pointed by I. So it's very simple. Not found case, I think it's very simple, that always will get a mismatch until the entire length of this. So outer for loop will get end and it will return minus 1 or 0 or whatever it is. Yeah, this we have that scenario. We have BITES. First three characters are matching here. Okay, but not the remaining one. But by the time we get the end of the source string, and hence it will return. And similarly, this is a matching, you know, first occurrence, etc. So this is very simple. Now let us see how this could be put in the form of an algorithm. So we have S starting from 0 to n minus 1 and pattern again 0 to m minus 1. This is like C string. So source is the given string and pattern to be searched. And if it's found, you return the position, that is I. Otherwise, you return minus 1. So this is not found. So this is not found. So it's very easy to explain how this is the outer for loop, right? Which will scan through the source string. So I starting from the first, that is 0th character, 0th character to n minus n, which I already explained. The inner for loop here, you can see here, inner for loop will be for the size of the pattern. So you can see here, J as long as it's less than M. Okay. The C string kind of thing. So it would scan starting from 0 to m minus 1. Right. So resetting can be done for the, you know, not found case. That means whenever there is a mismatch, or whenever there is a mismatch which occurs after few characters of the matching, we need to reset. So that's the resetting point, J equal to 0. Right. What is this while loop condition? This is for the length of the pattern. This is for the matching. Okay. Either, see, there are two conditions, like and. So J, as long as there are all the characters in the pattern matching with the source characters, then while loop will go fully and J will be equal to the size of the pattern. That means the pattern is there in the text. Otherwise, what happens? The J would have broken in between. So the size of the pattern, it will not be. For example, in this case, we have explained. So I'll just erase this. Okay. So what happens? This is a found case. So I is here and J is here. S of I plus J equal to P of J matches. J is incremented. So what happens? J would have come to the size of the pattern, that is say 3. So it would actually match with the entire size. That means if J equal to M. So otherwise, supposing if this is not X, let's say. So only two character match will be there, and hence J will not be 3, J will be 2, and hence this is not true. So it won't return. Again, what happens? The outer for loop I is incremented and J is again reset to 0. Again, it starts searching for the pattern. So whenever we have two conditions, we don't know because of which condition actually this while loop has broken. So that is the general logic. So either it's because of this or because of this, right? So supposing if there is a mismatch, this condition, see J is less than M, that's true, right? But this may not be true. That means the first character, let's say, first character of the source may not be equal to the first character of the pattern. Then what happens? This is false. This is true. So overall is false. So it will come back to this. So again, it is not equal, and hence use reset and again check. You know, the outer for loop will be executed and J is not incremented, all that. You know, when the condition is false, it won't increment and it's not equal, etc. So again, I is incremented, start checking from the next character onwards. Okay, so that's how, you know, the logic is built. Outer for loop is to scan the source starting from 0 to n minus m, that is pattern size, you know, pass. And inner for loop actually for the entire pattern, each and every character has to match with the any portion, substring of the source. If that is true, the job is done, so you can return. Now, supposing assume that until you come to the end, this condition is never satisfied. That means pattern is not found. So you will come to this. So there are two return statements. This is for the found case, right? This is for the not found case. So it's very simple that without any other functions, we can easily search for any given pattern in the string, and it's found, return the position of that, else return minus 1. You can see here I've given in the output as well. The second algorithm we will take up with the bit efficient one. Okay. Pattern matching algorithm is by using what is known as a table or a graph. I'll just show you the graph. The table is obvious. The same, you know, the information can be written into the form of a table. And this is more efficient because this movement of the I pointer, as we have seen in the previous algorithm, brute force method, is character by character. Here it's not like that. It can actually jump. It can, speed up the entire process of pattern matching process. So let us assume that a table or graph is derived for each pattern. So this is very important. It is not constant. For a given pattern, this is to be constructed, and it is independent of any given text. So it's normally for the pattern. So let us assume a pattern here is AABA. Only two characters, AA and BA. A and B, sorry. If T matches with the first two characters of P, let's say, that means AA, there are three scenarios, AA. Let us assume that in the text, you know, T, first two characters match. And the third one could be B, could be, or could be A, or could be any other character other than A and B. So these are the only three possibilities. See, we are trying to build this table or, you know, graph based upon the possibilities, right? Of what is the occurrence of these characters of the pattern which may appear, and so that we can speed up the entire process. I think you'll understand when we go through some examples. So there are three possibilities when the first two characters of the pattern match with the text. So the third one could be B, the third one could be A, or the third one could be any other character. In this case, we are mentioning that as X. Okay, let's take this example. Let the pattern P is AABA. Okay, now observe carefully this graph, how it's constructed. Because as we have already said, for each pattern, the graph has to be constructed. Now, the circles here, this is a graph because I think you would have already studied in, you know, graph methodology in mathematics, discrete mathematics, that graph is defined as a set of vertices and edges. Okay, so these are the vertices, these are the edges. It's a directed graph where we have some kind of a direction, the arrows which are mentioned, right? So how do we construct this graph? So each vertex indicates a state. So for example, Q0, Q1, etc. And the comparison for the pattern match problem can easily be done by using this graph being built for any given pattern. Okay, now we start with the first character, the first state, where if the first character in the text and the pattern is A, then you can move on to the second state, that is Q1, because there is a match, right? Because the first character is A in the pattern, and in the text also could be A. But in case if it is not A, it could be B, again you have to come back to the same state because, you know, you have to start looking for A. That's the idea. So look for the pattern in the text. So the states are very simple, that even if it is other than B, it will come back to this, obvious. Now, the first character itself is not A, but it could be B, so it should look for A. So it will keep on, you know, this is the arrow. So it will keep on be checking for whether there is an A or not. Okay. So when the first character is A, you can move on to the Q1 state. And from Q1 state, if the second character is B, you can come back, or any other character can come back. So if the first character itself is not A, then you look for A being in the state itself. So change of state occurs only when there is a match with respect to this pattern characters with the text. So we can easily understand that by going through all the states without this extra things. For example, the first character is A, yes, you can move to the second state. The second character is A, move to the second state, Q2. The third character is B, that's exactly what we have. No problem, you can go to state 3. The last character is A, done. AABA, it's found. So if you go through these, you know, straightforward, the pattern characters, the characters in the pattern, all the characters match with the text. That's what it means. The problem occurs when there is no match. For example, it could occur here, it could occur here, but unlike the previous brute force method, okay, now how it differs, we'll see. So the second character is anything, you know, B, come back, otherwise So the first two characters could be A, like AA. Now the third character, if it's B, fine, it goes to the third state. But supposing if it is A, the third one is also A, then you don't need to go back to this state, right? That's the advantage. You can be here only because you already tested this, and you know it's not going to match anyway because it is A. Again, subsequently it could be AA like that. So there is no need to come here, starting from here. But in the previous algorithm, I plus one, that means from second character we again start comparing, that is removed. That is the biggest advantage here. Because you already tested, you are in the same state like Q2. Because it is A, you can rest, look for AA. Okay, now assume that this is A, you come back here and it's B. No, there's no other go. You have to go back to this because it's totally different. You have to look for A again. So this is only a chance which we take. So again, go back to this and then look for AA. So that's the logic. So by building this graph for any given pattern, we can easily check with the text whether we should keep moving in the states, or we can start comparing from the middle so that we can avoid extra checking. So well, let's understand this with an example. Let us assume that the text is this. Remember, pattern is AABA. Okay, so now the first character matches with the pattern. So go to the second state. You can see here Q1, this is correct. A, you can see here. The second character is A, that's correct. You go to the second state. Now AABA, remember this pattern, AABA. Okay, if you want, I'll just write, it's already there here. It's already there here, okay, no problem. Or if you want, I'll write again. AABA, this is the pattern. Okay, so now this is correct. The second character is matching. B, the third is also matching. You can see here. So it goes to the third state. But unfortunately, the fourth character is not A, but it is C. Okay, so sorry. So when it is not that means something else. You can see here again, you come back to this Q0. You can see here. Because again, you have to look for the appropriate character. So now the second one is A. Now AABC, sorry, the fourth character is C. That's why you have totally come back to Q0. From Q0, again, it is A, it is matching. Go to the second state, B, no, it's not matching. So B, again, come back to Q0, you can see here. And again, A, go to the Q1, it's done because it's already reached the end of the text. So you can see here that first three characters are matching here with the pattern. But when it comes to the fourth character, since it's not matching, now it has to go back to the Q0 state. Q0, Q1, Q2, Q3, first three is okay, but the fourth character is not okay. So according to this graph, it says that there's no point. Again, you have to look for AA kind of thing. Let's go to the example two. Okay, now A, it's matching. Again, the same thing, AABA. First character is matching. Go to the second state, Q1, fine. But unfortunately, it is B. You can see here, B means again, you have to go to the Q0. So you are coming back to the Q0. After that, C. No, you have to be here only, Q0. You can see here, it is, you are in Q0. Now, this is there, AABA. Good, it is matching with the pattern. So go to Q1, Q2, Q3, done. So there's a not found, this is a found case. So it's very simple that using this pattern match graph, I can easily compare with the text character by character and then go to the state if it matches. Otherwise, you can be there only. So that means that you can avoid extra checking. If there is a mismatch occurs, going back all the way, assume that the pattern is so lengthy and there could be a mismatch occurring at the last character, then whatever you have done, it's all waste. But here it's not like that. It is partially, you can actually start comparing. That means you can reduce the number of comparisons. So the the time taken, if you see the brute force method, we actually derive it of the order of n square, where it is a complexity analysis. I think you will study that in the next semester. So big O of n square, we know n into n minus 1, which is almost similar to n square. That means double for loop kind of thing. So it takes more time because where n is the length of the text. Normally the text size is more compared to the pattern size. So obviously it is n square algorithm, but here it is not. We can make it actually linear even if the order of n. Okay, now we will summarize this. I'll just quickly write down. Right, what we have studied, we have just introduction, introduce the concepts of the fundamentals of the string on the terminologies of the string, what kind of ASCII characters, then you have the single quote, double quote, character, how to store that. Okay, storing of course is another concept which you have used. Storing your characters or string, we can have fixed size or variable with fixed or linked kind of arrangement. So three methods we have studied how to store the strings. Next we have the functions like manipulations or modifications of the function, strings. For example, it could be substring, it could be length of the string, or it could be index, etc. Then we have the word processing. So that means how to use these strings in order to process. So you can have for instance processing of the strings like insertion, insert, delete, then replacement. Replacement, right? So how to insert a new string into a given position, how to delete for starting from some position, how many characters you want to delete, you have a new string to be replaced for any given pattern match. So pattern matching and word processing kind of applications which is built into these functions. And pattern match algorithms, we have studied A and B, two methods. What are these two methods? The first one is a brute force method. The second one is a graph based method or a tabular based method. So what we have here is that the pattern, given pattern, is searched in the given source string. So we can just have a brute force approach of using two pointers, I and J, one for the source and another for the pattern, and keep comparing. And as long as the size of the pattern, length of the pattern is matching with this loop, what we have, the inner loop, then it's found. Otherwise it's not found. So you have to increment your I, that is S plus J, and then look for this pattern in the, if it's so, position of the pattern in the text is returned, otherwise minus one. The second one is graph based method, where states are shown in terms of the vertices and moving to one state to the other is given in terms of the edges. So you can look for any pattern in the string, given string or a text, very fast compared to the brute force method. We can use this logic even for replacement. So we can adopt these methodologies for solving several problems under word processing and write programs, maybe in C or Java, things like that. Because string processing is a very important kind of methodology which is required in many applications. Maybe at a later point of time, I will meet you all again with real world examples. See, these are some of the textbook or for study purpose, but how do we use this in the real world examples? Data structure itself, even today, a lot of algorithms, maybe STACK, Q, as we'll be studying next module, all these things are helpful in solving some real world problems. So that we will keep it separately. Otherwise, it's goodbye. Thank you for watching.